Tagore once said, where the mind has not been broken into fragments by narrow domestic walls, into that heaven of freedom, my father, let my country awake. 4 years ago, I had a profound personal tragedy, and I did what all millennials do when they're depressed. I locked myself up in my room, and I fell down a wormhole into the deep, dark corners of the World Wide Web. I discovered Christopher Hitchens. I discovered George Carlin. I watched so many episodes of The Kardashians that I'm not willing to disclose at this moment. And finally, when the pleasures of unemployment started to wear a little thin, I researched job opportunities. Call it luck, call it destiny or whatever, my eye fell on the MSF Delhi website. Tonight, I'd like to highlight the importance of the work done by this Nobel Peace Prize winning organization that provides healthcare to marginalized populations in over 70 countries. MSF, or Médecins Sans Frontières, which is French for Doctors Without Borders, is an independent humanitarian aid organization that provides healthcare to marginalized populations in areas of armed conflicts, epidemics, natural disasters, and exclusion from healthcare. It is a completely impartial, apolitical, and independent organization that remains neutral in all conflicts. It does not take any side. Patients who seek treatment from MSF are treated based solely on their medical need, and they are not discriminated against based on their gender, color, ethnicity, or more importantly, political affiliation. So what does that mean? You don't worry about anyone's political affiliation when they come to our hospitals. That basically means that when I walk into my hospital, I can see a child, I can see a civilian, I can see a military officer, and I can even see an ISIS fighter on the same day, sometimes in the same ward. So my first mission was in Somali region, Ethiopia. While being culturally identical to Somalia, with all of the population identifying themselves as Somali, it remains being a part of Ethiopia, while claimed and fought over by both the countries. My brief was to run a primary healthcare center run by the Ethiopian Ministry of Health in Somalia. So I had to manage the maternity ward, the HIV-TB program, the outreach, emergency, and the pediatrics ward. So what followed was a blur of driving around in helicopters, riding around in land cruisers across the desert landscape to the remotest of remote villages that haven't seen a doctor in decades, befriending and supervising an all-male, all-Somali staff, witnessing the horrors of female genital mutilation, which is basically female circumcision, and I had to learn how to deliver a baby through a mutilated and scarred birth canal. Coming home covered in blood and urine and sweat and chlorine and falling asleep under the most breathtaking canopy of starlight. I was really hooked to the job, to the adrenaline, and to the absolute adventure that came with it. So what has kept me coming back to MSF? I was supposed to go to Somalia, and after that I was supposed to pursue my postgraduate degree in the United States. But here we are 4 years later. What was supposed to be a one and done mission became a 4 year long career with missions to South Sudan, Nigeria, Yemen, and the most beautiful country that has affected me the most, Syria. So like I said, what has kept me coming back to MSF is more than the adventure and the sense of exhilaration that comes with bombs being dropped and airstrikes all around you. It feels like you're in a movie sometimes. What has kept me coming back is the ideology. Like I said before, they formulate their policies based purely on medical need. Their agenda remains unadulterated by any sort of considerations about the person's ethnicity or caste or race or religion. At the core of their policies lies a genuine respect for people who live differently than you, and an identification of the fact that everyone is deserving of health, happiness, and dignity. Another thing that has kept me coming back to MSF is that I really admire the fact that they persevere in providing healthcare even in life-threatening challenges. In 2016, one of the places I worked in, which is the Malakal POC site in South Sudan, POC means protection of civilians. A site like this in South Sudan was bombed killing 26 of our colleagues and patients. But MSF persevered despite that. So the background of the refugee camp that I worked in South Sudan was a three-year-long civil war that has claimed many casualties and claimed many civilian lives and forced millions of people to flee their homes. It was in one such refugee camp that I worked. So in Nigeria, that was my next mission. We had to provide more than just healthcare and just provide more than just medical supplies. Earlier this year, MSF gave about 1,000 tons of food to displaced people, and we provided about 1,000 tons of food to children with malnourished families and also internally displaced people. We provided the refugee camps with water taps, petrol to power the water taps, latrines and other mode of sanitation. We vaccinated about 130,000 children against measles and pneumonia, and provided about 10,000 people with SMC, which is seasonal malaria chemoprophylaxis. The place where I worked in is a state called Borno State, which has witnessed a violent insurrection by the extremist group of Boko Haram. It is in this place that I worked, and I ran an inpatient therapeutic feeding center for malnourished patients. We faced a similar situation in Yemen. All the actors in the armed conflict in Yemen, including the Saudi red-led coalition and the Houthi rebels, have perpetrated and are continuing to perpetrate unspeakable atrocities on civilians and civilian-led infrastructures like hospitals, schools, and markets. And in 2015 and 2016, we tragically and unacceptably lost 26 colleagues in four separate bombings all over Yemen. And the attack on Abe's hospital claimed 19 lives, including colleagues and patients. We were forced to withdraw our activities from Yemen, which we only resumed in November 2016, responding to what the United Nations called the world's worst cholera outbreak in history. And it was in one such cholera treatment center that I worked. It has been a wonderful journey. I have learned a lot about medicine. I have learned a lot about health. I have learned a lot about the forces of disease that work within a human body and even within a community. I've also learned a lot about people's incredible capacity for hope. I've learned a lot about love and God. It has been, of the many moments that bear mentioning tonight, a few come to mind. I've slept in tents that are made of some sort of translucent material, and they glow in the moonlight for some reason. It's a strange glow that happens in the moonlight and fireflies. I've slept in these kind of tents with the sound knowledge that I've saved at least one life that day. I've held babies that I've just delivered and wondered whether this child will grow up to be the transformative leader that will lead the country out of strife and poverty. I have found community and family among people that look and sound and behave nothing like me. I've made friends from all over the world. Let's see, there's Canada, there's England, there's France, there's Peru, there's Austria, and there's Sudan. I haven't visited any of them, but when I do, I'm sure I'll save a lot of money on Airbnb costs. Maya Angelou once said, "I come as one, but I stand as 10,000. What I'm most grateful to MSF for is that it has identified for me an army of like-minded people who practice science and logical thought and substantive discussion over petty prejudices and brainless bigotry. We are misfits, we are iconoclasts, we are children of the zeitgeist, united only by the dream of contributing towards the creation of a world that is devoid of the narrow domestic walls that Tagore talks about. We are the architects of a new century that judges people based purely on the content of their character and nothing else. We are barefoot, we are mystical, we are wild-haired, and we are pure of spirit. If you want to join us, if you have unbridled idealism and fearlessness and a hint of madness, if your empathy is not shackled by whether the person you're dealing with is black or white or Christian or Muslim or atheist or homosexual, or if you truly believe that a child's potential should not be dictated by geopolitical context or poverty or political apathy, if you truly believe that, join us. We come as one, but we stand as 10,000. Thank you.